Thank you. Hello. That's better. Right, I wonder what was wrong there. So thank you very much for staying till the end of the day for me. Well, I guess some of you have got later flights or a good reason to stay around. I've been asked to close the conference talking a little bit about some of my recent experiences and then blending in some of the work we've been doing at the conference here with the bug bash that many of you have been taking part in. So my mission is to help bring bug-free education to the world, which sounds quite a grand title. I'll explain a little bit about what I'm trying to achieve by working with many other people around the world. So global context, India is 1.2 billion people roughly now. This data is from 2010. Kenya, 40 million, Chile, 17 million people. The numbers are their ranking in terms of population. So only China is larger than India in terms of population. Current estimates for the number of schools in India, 1.3 million government recognized schools, plus all the private schools that the government kind of doesn't worry about too much. So I'm guessing in the order of 2 million schools in India. And if we look at Kenya, we've probably got 100,000 schools, et cetera, et cetera. So we have lots and lots of schools out there. I started accidentally. I speak at conferences like this. Occasionally at the swankier conferences, they would give me a little bit of money. And rather than spend the money on me, I would send it out to a small charity in Kenya that helps with widows and orphans and providing animals and feeding orphans and all that good stuff. Didn't really worry about it, just gave the money to my friend. He ran the charity, I trusted him. He finally nagged me to come out to Kenya and said, look, I wanted you to see what I've been spending your money on. Okay, you know, why not? So I'm going to spend a week out there, did a little bit of high-tech stuff in Nairobi, and then went out to Western Kenya and did the usual thing, which is the children sing, cut the ribbon of the classroom, talk to the teachers, try and understand what the heck goes on in a school in Kenya. In two of the schools, they had nowhere for the teachers to sit. There simply wasn't a building. They had no paper for the children to write on. They had no books to teach with, clearly no electricity. And probably about half the teachers were unqualified teachers. A third of the kids are orphans. Typically, the parents are dying of AIDS in that region. It's prevalent. So that was the situation. We found ourselves two more schools had some sort of room for the teachers to sit in. It's probably about this size. They had some sort of paper in it, so a few seed catalogs, 10 years old. Calendars on the wall were about 7 years old. That was it. No books to teach with. So let's imagine you're a child in that school. You could be anywhere from, I don't know, 5 up to about 25. Funny enough, in Kenya, they keep the kids back if they don't pass the annual exams. So you end up with these strange, disparate things where you have the chap here who's 7 foot tall alongside children who are 3 foot tall. And eventually they finish schooling. Some of them actually finish the qualifications, some just drop out. Where do a lot of them end up? Well, they either stay where they are, which is subsistence farming, and they're probably going to repeat what their parents did, which means basically have sex, possibly have children, typically die of AIDS, not the best way out, or they move to the slums of Nairobi, and it happens that lots of Western Kenyans are living in the Kibera slums of Nairobi. Not a great choice. So how do you break that cycle? Well, you're not just going to break it by feeding the kids and building classrooms, are you? Because the teaching is rote teaching. Meanwhile, I was traveling with a Kindle. Most of you know what a Kindle is. My one had 3G built in. It was the e-ink, the older style one, battery life of about a month, and I fly around the world with it. And I happened to be reading the Financial Times newspaper every morning at 6 a.m. Kenyan time. You know, the sun came up, I'd read the paper, then I'd go about my trips and do stuff. And wherever I went, the 3G just worked. So I could look at the Amazon store, buy books. And I kind of thought, maybe this would help. You know, I can't really afford a lot of money, I'm self-funding this, but if I could provide a Kindle to a school, would it help with the teaching? Could I get curriculum material and stuff like that? So, I realized I should have moved forward slightly. This is the sort of questions I was asking myself about what happens after the kids leave school. And I realized I had some skills here, some possibly unusual skills. I've been an engineer since I was 16. I was trained to fix airplanes, military airplanes, and when they trained us, our job was to be able to fix it by ourselves if necessary, which is a fairly complex task. So 3 years of engineering training, then go out and fix airplanes, and then move into computing in about 86. ran an online business for 11 years, phenomenally successful, sort of 10, 15 years before the internet, ended up working at Google, eBay, all these sort of companies. So I knew a little bit about scalable systems. I'd worked with global users since the 80s, and I'd basically learned how to design engineering systems that were reliable, even when the individual bits and pieces weren't. So we all live and thrive on TCP/IP. TCP provides reliability on top of an unreliable protocol. So that's kind of what we do, whether we know it or not. So I was trying to find ways to do something similar in anything I do in technology, and to do something that I could scale from small and try stuff to potentially 100,000 schools or more. So that's the engineering challenge to do this stuff. I was interviewed in Chile recently. I don't speak Spanish. I understand a few words of it. And they claimed I'd invented a bunch of stuff I hadn't. So this is a disclaimer. I haven't invented anything here. What I'm kind of doing is taking bits and pieces that I find and put them together. So some of you have heard of a Raspberry Pi. There's prizes at the end of this conference with Raspberry Pis. This is one in a clear box. These are about $40, these computers, 512 megabytes of RAM. They're running an ARM processor. They have a bunch of USB. They have a little Ethernet port. They take power. They've got HDMI coming out, bit of audio. I don't know. Can you catch? They're fairly robust. So that's a Pi. Well, this is a Pi with a battery. And this has 128 gig SD card on, 5,000 hours of video, Wikipedia, bunch of other stuff. Total cost of this, without a solar panel, about $100. With a solar panel, $130. Khan Academy, how many people have heard of Khan Academy here? Oh, wow, okay, you've got a treat for the rest of you. So Sal Khan was teaching his niece, I believe, in America. He's an Indian living in America, and his niece had flunked some maths test. So he agreed to teach her, and was originally doing it using Skype, eventually put the videos online on YouTube. A bunch of people found the videos, got excited, and he's made himself about 3,000 videos on education, and it's become a worldwide phenomenon in schooling. So absolutely brilliant, isn't it? Imagine you can watch videos in chemistry, physics, biology, mathematics, economics for free. Well, that's great, except only one third of the world has reliable internet. So an intern a couple of years ago turned up at Khan Academy and said, couldn't we do something about making this available for the rest of the world? So a sort of offline version. That became the Khan Academy Lite project done by what became Learning Equality, which is a couple of people working out of UCSD in the States. The next thing is Wikipedia. I assume that all of you know what Wikipedia is. So that's actually sort of run by the Wikimedia Foundation, and this is one of their projects. Kiwix is another, and many of you have met Kiwix from getting involved in the bug bash at this project. So it started as the offline Wikipedia reader, but it's branched into the sort of universal player available on multiple operating systems and Android. And it's also a web server, and we actually run as a web server on the Raspberry Pi. Wikipedia contributors, I mean, there's so many people involved in this, and I'm just putting these things together. The Rachel project, in fact, combined Khan Academy, Kiwix, and a bunch of other materials and made it into a single image file that we can either run off a memory stick on a computer like Windows with a little web server, or we can run it on the Raspberry Pi. And I essentially do that and then do a little bit of refinement of that work. I'm a software engineer. Simon didn't laugh. Okay, I'm the software engineer, doesn't commit much code, but never mind, I pretend I'm a software engineer. So I tried to look at these projects and think, how can I actually do this based on what we know in software that seems to work quite well? So my projects start small. I realize I can't solve the problems. I can't turn up knowing what's gonna happen. I've been in India for the last 10 days visiting schools, and the first thing I learned when I turn up is whatever I thought was gonna work doesn't work. Like one school says, well, we've got distributed Wi-Fi and we've got a 3G connection on a water tower. Sounds brilliant. It gives me about sort of 60 bytes a second. So we had to put all the tablets in the back of a car and drive back to a city to configure them. So we thought we were just going to do a little bit of online configuration with the school. That's fairly typical of the things I have to sort out. So in all the projects, we do monthly iterations. I ask for monthly reports from the schools. I encourage them to learn, and I learn each time. Try lots of equipment. Most of the stuff doesn't quite work. We refine, replace, enhance, upgrade. And we do sort of mini retrospectives of what we're doing to try and get involved and try and find ways to improve what we do. In Kenya, when I started the project, I'll go into details of it, but I spent, I think, $1,500 on equipment to launch six schools and affect roughly 1,000 people. So it's not a lot of money to do these things if you do it right. If you look at the education budgets in Kenya, I suspect they're spending something like $10 million a year on e-learning material, which is written in that favorite old tool called Flash. And there's just so much wastage in terms of education and the money that's being spent there. And as engineers, we can probably solve these problems for something like a tenth or a hundredth of the cost in a tenth of the time. That's what I believe, and that's what I'm aiming to prove here. I try to maximize learning through diversity. So in the last 2 months, I have been in Kenya, working in schools there, working in Chile and Santiago, and the southernmost city in the world, which is called Punta Arenas. In India, I'm working in Bangalore, in city schools, and I'm working in Chennai, a school 2 hours' drive away in a field. So this is fairly typical of the sort of patterns, because we want to learn through diversity. We use different equipment, different tablets, different power supplies, different PIs, different systems, different languages, all intended to help us learn effectively. I've been involved in open source since about 2006, basically since I joined Google and realized that this made sense. And things like Selenium, I'm really pleased to see the project go from strength to strength. So virtually everything we're using is free and open source, but occasionally some of the software is just free. So for instance, one of the software we use to lock down the tablets is a free download from Android Market, Google Play. And I don't worry too much about the software being open source for that purpose. But everything else is open source as well, which means we can actually modify it. We can enhance it, and I've been encouraging some of you to do that for providing translations, for instance. The content's free to share, free to copy, free to modify. So you can create your own content. The schools can create their own content. We can get people in countries. So in India, you can re-record the videos because sometimes it makes sense to have it with your local script. You don't want me writing in English or in Spanish if you're working in Telugu. Just doesn't make much sense. So the focus is how can we work on this together? So I said that I start small. I started with six schools, each with a Kindle in February. I'd seen enough failed IT projects, particularly in Kenya, where you normally get, can I borrow you just for a second?
Sure.
Do you mind coming up on stage? With your tablet, please. You'll actually see a picture a bit like this in a moment. So I'd like us to do this this way, and I'd like us to do this. So lots and lots of pictures like this, tons of them. And 6 months later, that's still in the box.
Jeez.
Not the greatest way of using technology. And I said, thank you.
Thank you.
So that's fairly typical of the projects I saw. This school is a school near Bangalore. I was coming out last year for a conference on software testing, and I basically had a Skype conversation thinking I was turning up with Kindles. And they said, well, actually, we've got this computer room where we've had computers donated 2 years ago. No one goes into this room because we don't know what to do with them. The school only had four classrooms. This is an orphan school. And they basically wouldn't use it as a normal teaching classroom. I said, why don't you just throw the computers away and use it as a classroom? You know, if you're not going to use the computers, don't make this into a sort of shrine. But as you might see, the kids are actually playing a game called Zumbinis. My children are now 22 and 19, two daughters. When they were this high, they played Zumbinis. They still play Zumbinis today. My mother's 75, and she still plays Zumbinis. So it gave me a clue that this software is quite useful. It basically helps you to learn problem-solving and mathematics skills on Windows 95. And thankfully, the old computers donated by corporates are about good enough to run Windows 95. So there we go, we're using it. And in fact, we've got six schools commissioned by January this year, just two interns doing it part-time. They go to a school for a month, train the kids. Oh, the kids open and close the schools. The kids have the keys for the schools in India, not the adults. Because the adults come by bus, and if they turn up at all, you know the story better than I do, many of you, but if the teacher turns up at all, they come an hour late. So kids open and close the schools. Staggered me when I first saw this. The teacher ratio is roughly 70 kids to one. The official ratio in India is 30 to one in a state school. So I won't bore you with the details, but not all teachers turn up all the time. You know this better than I do. I worked with World Reader, founded by an ex-Amazon exec, and he did deals with lots of publishers, working through the Amazon content distribution mechanisms to provide content. So I was able to buy hundreds of e-books, I think 500 I bought, for roughly a dollar each at the time. And these are available in Kiswahili. They're directly relevant to the curriculum in Kenya. really helps the teachers. And now I've got 11 schools with Kenya, in Kenya with Kindles. I also experimented with 3G Wi-Fi devices. I don't know if everyone's picked up my bags. They weigh about 10 or 15 kilos of electronics. That's my hand luggage. I normally take a couple of T-shirts with me. Everything goes in hand luggage because the airlines will not refund you if your bag is stolen and has technology in. So I've learned that the hard way. Anyway, you need to travel with all your stuff, so I travel with 3G Wi-Fi. This little thing costs about $15. It's a 3,000 milliamp hour battery. And what's it sold for? It's sold for you lot and me to charge my smartphone. No big deal, it's kind of cute. Even has a little torch in it. Now, in the equator, with no electricity, this is actually quite useful, having a torch. So not a bad thing to have. But what it actually acts as is a UPS. In India, power isn't always on all the time. Sometimes power's on until about 10:15, and then it comes back again about 11. Then it goes off until 2. This battery will keep a Pi going for 4 hours. This will keep one going for up to about 16 hours. So it means that providing it gets charged from something sometime during the day, you can basically run the school and run the software without interruption, no matter what the power situation is. And I use these solar panels in Kenya. They have a lot of sunlight there, so we use that to power them. And it's that sort of simple engineering, which doesn't cost a lot. These are hard to find, ones that allow you to charge them while they're being discharged. Most of them will turn the discharge off when you plug power in, which defeats the purpose of what I want to use them for. I deal with the manufacturers and try and encourage them to do more of these, please. Do a lot of work with solar panels. I test them. I carry meters with me because they never live up to their claims. Nothing like the sort of 7 watts they claim. I normally get about 4 watts out of them. And I'll come on to the tablets and pies in a moment. I will work with anyone, anywhere in the world, pretty much, providing they'll work with me. So I don't mind whether you're a government, I don't mind whether you're a small school, I don't mind if you're a single teacher or an intern, but the only commitment is you've got to actually work too. So I'm not going to solve your problems for you, I'm not going to give you all the toys. You work with me, I'll do everything I can to help you, and I'll help you to grow the projects. So that's the commitment I make. I'm trying to help people learn competencies. I fly home 7 a.m. tomorrow morning. The schools here have to survive without me. Schools everywhere else have to survive without me, so I'm training people up. And of course, I'm encouraging you to do likewise. What I'm not trying to do is build a big charity or anything like that. I'm actually trying to help just demonstrate by example that one person can do, so hopefully a few more people will copy the good bits of what I do, and then together we can actually improve things. In Kenya, I've now said to the schools, if you want more Kindles, I'd like you to donate a little bit of money. I paid for the original Kindles. Now, the reason for this isn't because I want money. It's because they all have budgets, you know, a varying amount of money. I want to know how relevant is the Kindle to them, now they've used them for a year, compared to spending money on firewood, building metal desks for the kids to sit at, or lockers, whatever else is that they have to pay for. Because if the Kindle isn't any good, I'm going to find out because they're not going to pay for it. If the Kindle's really important for them, they'll pay a little bit of money towards it and I'll pay the rest. And they have a budget per pupil for books per year. It's not a lot of money, probably a few tens of rupees per pupil, but that's the sort of money I'm saying make that contribution. And the e-books are actually cheaper when you buy it that way than buying the physical books. And they don't get destroyed by the rains. So it actually works quite well. The example here on the bottom right is a school report written by the school. This paper is normally secondhand. It's normally reused, so I quite often get the interesting scribbles on the back of it. And they're just digitally photographed by someone who works out in Kenya. He emails them to me. So that's how I get the feedback. A couple of examples then of progress in a couple of countries. On the left, we can see school teachers who are actually using tablets for the first time. They're actually using the Raspberry Pi for the contents. I visited a refugee camp. This is a unique privilege to see the first undergraduate university in the world in a refugee camp, in Dadaab refugee camp. That's near Somalia. The refugees have been there for about 15 years in some cases. So you've got refugees who were that high, went all the way through schooling. What happens? Well, it turns out they've only got one teacher for something like every 500 children. So they're actually setting up the undergrad campus using degree courses from Canada and from Kenya to help train teachers who can work there or anywhere else in Kenya. So I was looking at the technology side of it, and those are some students using a Kindle and a Raspberry Pi running on solar in 45-degree heat. Now, one of the surprises of going there is that a lot of the equipment had been donated. I won't name the company, but I looked at this, and it was full of sort of servers, and I was asking people, what's this server for? What are you going to do with this server? They said, we're actually building a computer room. This is a place with no mains electricity. So they've got a 27 kVA generator, diesel generator, backed up with a 25 kVA diesel generator to power a server that probably draws 500 to 1,000 watts, an 800 gigabyte tape drive. I said, what are you going to put on this? What's it for? They don't know. So they've been donated all this wonderful kit. I mean, it's a wall. It's this much equipment, 93 boxes, I think it was, for one classroom for 40 kids, 48 young adults, sorry. No one actually knows what they're going to do with it. And they're building a computer room in the desert. They could actually use air-cooled computers. They could power from a single solar panel and do the same teaching. So there are much simpler solutions than sometimes the ones that people who don't have a technical background think about. So again, you're technologists, perhaps you could help in these sort of projects. So that's the current status. I've got 11 schools with Kindles, 3 with Android tablets and Raspberry Pis, 1 being an unofficial school in the Kibera slums that's doing some great work in terms of education. And funny enough, people find money to pay for that schooling. The same the world over, people, parents will pay for private schooling for their kids if they view it as being more valuable than the state system. And then Dadab has just got a solar-powered Pi for fun. I went to Chile 3 weeks ago, went to Santiago, which is the capital, about 6 million people, and launched a project with one of the schools. You can see an example on the leftmost slide for junior children, so up to the age of about 12. And they've got 9 tablets and a Raspberry Pi, and the school's supported by a foundation who've taken it over in a slum area. I worked with an organization called Teach First. There's something similar in India called teachforindia.org. They're not currently in here. They are in Chennai and in northern India. And what Teach First does is they take graduates who didn't train as teachers and help them to learn how to be teachers, and then work for a couple of years, typically teaching in the poorer schools. And then they're free to go about their business, and some stay as teachers, some move back into industry, some work at Microsoft now, for instance. And then I had a chat with the Ministry of Education. I did something similar in Kenya. Punta Arenas, I've got 3 schools launched, I met the region government, and have given them everything they need to commission their own schools. I said, stop worrying about what the state is going to do for you, the national government. You've actually got computers, as you'll see in the middle, by the way. Sorry for the camera, but if you look at the middle slide, those are laptops. This school had 50 computers in for the children. 0 were commissioned and available to use. So these are all laptops. Some of them have got broken keyboards. So now with the software they've got, they can actually use these. They can use Kiwix, they can use Wikipedia, they can use Khan Academy, all for free. All they have to do is copy it, boot the computer up, and use it. Now, hopefully that will help with the education. Right, computer stuff. A nice company called Google asked me how many tablets I would like to help with the project. I said, I don't know, 20, 30. Just a wild stab in the dark. This is about January time. I said, we're going to give you 150. Well, thank you. What do I do with 150? Well, I shipped 60 to Kenya, 75 to India, and 15 to Chile. The Chile ones I took by hand. The other ones were shipped into country. And that's what I'm using now to commission projects over here. A stack of Raspberry Pis. That's the old Model B, the one that's on the floor. I use those in Chile because they have a lot of data. So the Chile Wikipedia is 19 gigabytes compressed. So I need the extra storage, and I'm running 128 gig SD cards. Here, getting Wikipedia in Telugu, Kannada, Tamil is a relatively small content. I'd like more of you to write more articles, please. But nonetheless, it all fits very nicely on a 64 gig SD card. Power is more of a problem here than there, so I use the newer, lower-powered Model B Pis. They draw about 1.3 watts instead of about 2.5 watts. And that subtle difference, so I'm talking about watts. I'm not talking about hundreds of watts for a desktop computer. 2 watts, 1.5 watts. And you can serve 25 concurrent video streams from that device. So 25 people can be watching different videos concurrently. Power, I've talked a little bit about this. I buy lots of these mobile phone power packs. I try to buy everything in country as well. So I went down to SP Road. For those from Bangalore, you know what SP Road is. It's where you buy your tech from. Sort of 100 computer shops jammed together in about 50 feet, as far as I can tell. The narrowest one being the door width I met, 2.5 feet wide, 80 centimeters. And I go and see what I can buy there. I can buy a Raspberry Pi Model B+, cost me 3,000 rupees. The case costs 250. I'm just looking for where I put the damn thing. Oh, I threw it at you. The one I threw at you, that's the one I bought in the SP Road. Yeah. And the SD card, 2,500 rupees on the SP Road. Because I want to know what's actually cost to buy real computers in country. In Punta Arenas, I bought an MTV Android tablet for about $40. MTV being the brand, these were being sold off cheap by a department store. Buy it, try it, see if it works. Pretty simple stuff. And then I use 4-port USB chargers, beautiful little devices, travel the world with them, and they'll charge an iPad. They'll charge, of course, all the stuff I have. So I'm trying to look at how to make this practical and scalable. Everything is off the shelf. So there's nothing invented here. I simply buy on Amazon or whatever it is, or in the local stores, put things together. I use open content, open source. I've mentioned about testing the diversity. So I've tried Nooks, I've tried Kobos, I've tried the color ones, I've tried the 11-inch screens. I've got stacks of old computer stuff at home, old being 6 months old now, that doesn't quite work. But at least I know what the alternatives are now. Always looking for simplicity in the solution, simplicity in what we have, because this has to be copied in places where they don't have much IT skills, and it simply has to work. Just about everything I measure, test, gather data and evidence, because without that, who am I going to convince? And then I work with people around the world, so mostly informal relationships. I work with large companies like Cognizant, Google. I work with tiny little Christian charities, whoever's willing to work with me, basically. I'm not a teacher, so what the heck do I know going into a school? Well, I try to do some sort of sanity checking by talking to professional teachers. I talk to people involved in this sort of area around the world and try to understand what makes sense. In India, I read your local press. I've read one of your previous president's books on education. Chetan Bhagat, whatever. He writes novels. Yes. So he's written a very nice book about what young Indians want. About a third of it's on education. It seems to make sense to me. So try to get data in country just to see what makes sense here, and of course, visiting the schools in person. I focus on teaching teachers. So these are examples where I'm actually teaching them about TCP/IP. Sounds a bit weird. The top left picture there is in a classroom with no power. A chalkboard is all they have available. But they need to understand this stuff, because if they don't, then things fall apart and stuff stops working. And guess what? Stuff stops working is wasted technology. By the way, you have to drink Coca-Cola branded drinks in Kenya when you go and visit a school. So it's always Fanta or Coca-Cola every single event. On the upper right, that's a teacher teaching the other kids and teachers how to use the software on the Android tablet. Bottom left, that's me again sketching out about subnets, teaching an IT support guy how to connect this into his existing computer network in Chile. And this is a fairly special school near Chennai, where this is the head of the school and the kids working. That was taken on Tuesday, that picture. Onto the software then. I'll group software into sort of three bits. We've got code, that's stuff that does stuff. We have the text and other resources, which are the user interface that communicates. And then we have the contents, which could be Wikipedia, the videos, the education, exercises, and ebooks. All of those are running, by the way, on the Pi, and some additional software on the Android tablets. When I visited schools last year in India, I found the children here are taught in the local language in Canada until the age of about 12. So if you're using, they were using Edubuntu software, which isn't translated into Canada. Furthermore, these children in Bangalore, and they're looking at a map of India, which is about 1 to 1 million. Now, a child in Bangalore wants to know a map about Bangalore. They want to know about the region around them. They don't want to look at, you know, here's Hyderabad, here's Bangalore, here's Chennai sort of thing. So imagine that people can contribute this. Again, it's all open source. But for some reason, with 1.1 something billion people here, there's no one contributing to these projects, which to me seems like a bit of a tragedy. So wouldn't it be great if we could actually help out and at least translate the user interfaces and then also help provide local content? And that's going to be effective for the kids. A couple of screenshots. Rachel is the main project. It's web-based. It runs off the Pi. And it's got this whole collection of software. And then that's an Android tablet, which is locked down with this free software. to mean that it stops the kids sort of accidentally deleting Chrome or whatever off their devices. Some examples of the software side of things. Google has this concept. I'm going to call it volunteer days. I'm not sure what they call it internally. And a couple of Google developers in about June time got involved in the Khan Academy Lite project. And one of the things it was really suffering is the testing for synchronization. So the concept of a central server that's available on the internet, and it will synchronize all the reports and updates to there as a backup. And also, if you need to commission an extra device in the school, you can plug it in, log in, and it'll download all the content. Really elegant, but no automated tests for it. So the Google engineers helped write the automated tests for it. Wikimedia Foundation had a hackathon in Zurich, and we did a lot of programming on the Kiwix Android, which is when I first met Kiwix, actually meeting developers there, and they suckered me into that project too. So a great opportunity, about 150 people, a bit like this conference, really passionate and wanting to work on stuff. And then, of course, we're here now in the Selenium Conference in Bangalore, and we've had contributions of lots of bugs and automated tests. This is the latest data I had before I produced the slides, just coming here. We had 114 bugs filed, one already closed on the Kiwix software. Test automation, I think we've got about six branches that people have made of the code base. The code base, by the way, was a README file, so you've written all the rest of it, and I'm getting the pull requests now that we're going through at the moment and reviewing of contributions of automated tests for Kiwix. So that means we can help the open source project to improve their software. They already have continuous builds, by the way, so they just don't have enough tests. And hopefully we, being software testing experts, aficionados, can help fill that gap. And then in terms of contributions, I haven't seen any contributions yet in terms of translations and localization, but I would encourage you to do that to help us clean up the user interface. So it's available in Telugu, Kannada, Urdu, whatever the language is, because I don't speak all these languages, nor do any of the other developers. So it's only from volunteers contributing that this is going to happen. That's a URL for people on the video watching this afterwards. For the bug bash, we've got all the results on GitHub. Just because the conference is coming to an end, and for the people watching the videos, it doesn't mean we have to stop now. So please continue to get involved. It's wonderful when people report bugs. And you could, someone wrote a bug report saying, there's only about six things translated into Telugu. Well, to be honest, we kind of knew that. You know, the rest is in English. So you've told me there's a pothole in the road. Well, can you help me fill the pothole? And since you speak Telugu, and since you're probably computer literate, since you're at this conference, it'd be wonderful if you could just help us by giving us a couple of translations. It's one text file. That's all it takes. For Khan Academy Lite, it's in 10 languages. Again, none of the Indian languages. And the user interface, it would be great to have it available in other languages. And then the content is the bigger problem. So we've got about 5,000 videos available from, these are all from Khan Academy. Some people do subtitling, which is a good start, but that means you hear English, you read local language, your preferred language. Some people do dubbing, so they actually redub the videos, so you hear the local language, but what's projected on the screen is still in English. And then some people re-record the entire video and basically do the same content, but localized, including the written materials. So all that's useful to help. And you're helping all the people who watch Khan Academy too. All the content goes back to there and then comes from there into these other projects. Again, I simply don't know enough about apps. There's roughly 2 million apps on the app stores. So suggestions for apps that we can install on tablets that will help with education. I learn languages from Duolingo. It's a free piece of software. I don't think it's open source, but the content is contributed by many people. And it's a great way for me learning Spanish. So that sort of thing can help improve language learning. It gets me to practice speaking, comprehension, translation in both directions. And for many people, this is really useful when you're learning English as a second or third language. Even sometimes learning your original first language because it allows you to practice. The one challenge is it requires the internet connection for many of the things, which means we need an internet to use this software. Hopefully we'll be able to address that. Perhaps Duolingo will help with that too. The other thing is productionizing. So I'm taking what essentially is a small, inexpensive, not quite a toy, but this was meant to make computing fun for kids again. That was the intent of the Raspberry Pi. And kids can use this thing, which is called GPIO, to add sort of LEDs and robot arms and clever things. But they weren't intended to run unmaintained in a school which has got rain falling outside and it's got high temperatures for perhaps a year or two at a time. So helping me to productionize this stuff and make it robust and reliable, dealing with configurations, remote updates, all these things are useful, and I simply can't do it all by myself. That's it from me in terms of the presentation. We've got plenty of time for questions. Wait for the mic, because then it'll be on the recording.
You are sharing the courseware for across the globe, many countries you are sharing the educational content. Now, my question is, how will you ensure that for various grades, the content is relevant?
So the question is that the content is shared across the globe, how do we ensure the content is relevant?
Yes, yep. Relevant to a specific grade, you know.
Yeah. So the first thing is that I'm working directly in three countries. I'm helping indirectly in two more countries at the moment. So I'm helping indirectly in Zambia and in Uganda with schooling. And the software, so the Khan Academy Lite software, is probably in use in about 110 countries. So independently of me. Again, I'm just a consumer of this in many ways and a small-time contributor to code and a few other things. So from my perspective, when I go and visit schools, one of the first things a school's interested in is how closely does this fit our curriculum? Because most teachers are measured either implicitly or explicitly against the curriculum. Although it's cute to watch a video about the atom, if that's not relevant to their curriculum, they may not be interested in that topic. So it's something that what we find from usage is that lots of school children, lots of schools are using the Khan Academy content, the Khan Academy Lite software. So implicitly through use, it says that it's reasonably relevant. The other thing is that we're just scratching the surface of education here. What we're doing is we're augmenting existing teaching techniques. And some of the things I'll mention that may not be obvious until I mention them is when I stand in front of you, I control the speed, and you may listen and learn quickly, or you may ignore me, whatever it is, but you can't pause me and rewind. With a video, you can. If necessary, you can go and watch the videos five times until you get the concept. With the Khan Academy software, you can practice the mathematics exercises many times, and it encourages you to move on once it believes you've reached mastery, which is a certain number of questions correct without mistakes and without looking at hints. So that's kind of enhancing the current schooling model, but there's a lot more we can do in future that isn't just curriculum-based. Ultimately, we've got a lot of bright people. There's roughly 6.5 billion people in the world, and I would guess that around 3 billion are under 25. So all of us can learn, and the material that's available helps us to learn at whatever age we're at, and we shouldn't be limited to a school curriculum. So looking around this hotel, I see people in different colored clothing. I see the men in suits. Sometimes women in suits, they're typically the managers. You see the ones in purple, they're the mid-level people, and they both serve and they give orders. And then you see the people in gray and the people in white. The white are the lowest of the low. They're the ones with the sweeping brushes. The ones in gray are the normal ones who actually bring the coffee to me, and the one in purple is the one who gives it to me. Now I look at these people and think, how many years schooling did you have to do this? Was it 8 years, 10 years, 12 years? You got a degree to do this? You know, there's so much potential in humanity that we're missing out here. And one of the nice things about Khan Academy's work and some of these other materials is it's self-directed, self-paced learning. And I think that we'll see that schooling can transform itself way beyond what we believe in the next 10, 20 years if we encourage it to happen. One of the challenges in India, I think, is to do with culture and tradition and not wanting to change things. So that's going to be probably the biggest holding back in this country. But in other countries, they have their own approaches and their own challenges. So back to the question, I think it's reasonably accurate materials and reasonably relevant. A lot of people are using it. I learn by the examples of the schools. I've only just started this 18 months ago. I'm a newbie to this and working with some people who've done a lot more work in this area. And I would love the governments to look at alignment with curriculum. Curriculums can be good as well as, it's like standards. You know, standards are useful in the right way. So curriculums in the same ways can be useful. Does that answer your question?
Okay, I'll just like to jump on that a little bit. So one of my startups is Adventure Labs, and one of the things we've been trying to do is help kids learn mental arithmetics. And this whole concept of curriculum we found is actually gets in the way, because there are some kids who can learn way faster than the other kids, and we try to batch them into year of manufacturing is probably not the best way to batch them. So Khan Academy is doing it. A lot of other people are doing it as self-paced, pull-based learning. So if you can clear questions as quickly as possible, you keep moving through, you keep progressing. And if you're not, then you keep getting more hints and you keep getting more suggestions. So that helps everyone move at their own pace. But now suddenly you start putting, boxing them into curriculums and, you know, year of manufacturing, then I think it hinders the progress for everyone. So I think we need to move away from this curriculum-based thought process, in my opinion.
The school, which is at the bottom right-hand side, this Indian school, the children are multi-ages in the classroom, and the children are teaching the other children, and they're called learner educators, because they're primarily focused on learning, but they also educate the others, and the teachers are called educator learners, because the adults should be learning too. All this technology stuff that I've shown you is wonderful, providing you have motivated teachers involved in encouraging the children to learn. So the teacher's job hasn't disappeared, far from it, it's just changed. And it's more like a sort of agile coach or a facilitator who's working in the school, helping encourage the children to learn, and of course, sometimes dealing with discipline and the other problems in life. But it's really, really most important to have the passionate people involved. And then there's lots of schooling models. The Petzolozzi model, which came out of Switzerland, about 150 years old, again, has children teaching children. India, before the British came in, had children teaching children. There's a lot we can learn from history now that we've got the joy of technology that can help augment that learning.
Yeah, we had the Gurukul system, which essentially was, you know, a bunch of kids under one teacher, but they're all the different ages and kind of helping each other.
Thank you. Next question. There's one at the front here.
Thank you, Julian. It was very inspiring, and I think most of us feel very emotional, and we wanted to be connected. Unfortunately, the system here is, when I step out, I think I forget, right? Most of us carry a shorter memory, and we forget. How do you get more inspired and live with this and contribute back? If you tell us the success, and we would try to follow it.
Thank you for the question. And I am very, very aware of the pressures of real life. And it's cost me quite a lot, and my family quite a lot, for me to do this the last couple of years. So I gave up having a normal job, and I earn around a tenth of what I used to earn. But somehow I still managed to fly here, and somehow I still have new shoes and clothes and the rest of it. So it's taken care of one way or the other. There's things you can do in half an hour or less, especially if you know how to do a little bit of code. If you're familiar with sort of doing a checkout of a code base, then most of these projects are on GitHub, so you can go and check out the code, edit the translation file. If you're familiar with Android, everything's in a res file, and it's in a values-te, is Telugu, I think. So in there, there's a single file called strings.xml, and guess what? Most of it's in English, because no one translated it. So edit the file, and if you're familiar with using all the tools, check it, you can do a pull request, which is what some of you have been doing for the test automation. If you're not familiar, just email me the file. Email me the Word doc, and I'll take out the silly quotes that it puts in, and I'll paste it into the code base. So half an hour means you could maybe do 10 translations. You could do a little bit of testing. You maybe search the web and look for an app in your language. I don't know what your first or second language is, and suggest something like that. So little things like that. And then the other thing is to look at the concept of, can I give an hour a week to this? So we've got 168 hours a week of our lives, and all of us are busy, and all of us are going to die. So we're never going to finish everything we'd like to do. So if you're able to find 1 hour a week, at least one in the next month, and try reserving that hour and use that hour. I use a technique called the Pomodoro technique. Some of you may have heard of it. There's a free book called, it's at the pomodoro.org website, I think, or pomodoro.com. And the idea is a 25-minute period where you just focus on one task, and then 5 minutes rest. So you do two pomodori in an hour. So that sort of concept might work quite well for your day job as well as for anything like this. So chunking the tasks up into small pieces may help. And some of you may become mad enough to do a bit more than that. So I had a volunteer from Cognizant come down for 2 days to visit the school with me, and he donated a Raspberry Pi. He had one himself personally. He helped set things up. He's configuring the tablets. And he'll go back to his day job. And he has to catch up the 2 days' backlog of work, but he thought it was worth doing. So it doesn't have to be giving up your life or a month of your time even. You can do a day, an hour, just little bits. Thank you.
Any other questions?
My question is like similar to, I mean, related to what he asked right now. So I know that you already mentioned that you're working with companies like Google to drive this effort. But almost all of our companies have CSR teams, I guess. So like, are you already coordinating with the CSR teams from different companies to get this effort moving on?
Yes, so in India, companies beyond a certain size, I think legally now have to donate 2% of your profits to CSR programs. It's roughly that, isn't it? And Oracle would be a large company, Cognizant would be a large company, eBay probably a large company, et cetera, et cetera. So the question is, what do you do with your 2%? Well, if your background and expertise is in software testing, maybe a little bit of software testing would be useful. If your background expertise is writing code, then maybe it's working with code. It may be you want to actually get involved in teaching the schools too. That's also brilliant. But build on your strengths. And one of the funny things I see in CSR programs is sometimes the staff are doing things that are outside their comfort zones, and they've kind of forgotten their skills, which would really help these projects. Ultimately, we're using a lot of technology here. And I would think all of you in this room are technologists. So think about how you use your technological skills and of course, do the other stuff as well. So that's what I encourage you to do, and encourage your CSR people. I know from dealing with the ones in Cognizant, they really want to help their staff. Their mission is to help their staff to do whatever they want to do, and so there's some people who are passionate about spina bifida, so they help with that. Some are passionate about autism, they work with people with autism, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. Some are passionate about the school they came up from because they were the lucky kid who made it to university and now has the big, relatively well-paid job in technology. But the rest of the people in that school didn't. So they want to give back, and they do that through the CSR programs.
Absolutely agree, because I have participated in a blackboard painting as part of my CSR team. So it would be good to contribute to technology.
Yes, thank you. Yeah. There's a question right at the back. The microphone's right at the front. Oh, there's another one in between. So that microphone will come back to you, sir, and there's a question here.
Yeah. First of all, I would like to appreciate the service that you're actually, planning for. And it's not actually a question, but what kind of a volunteer volunteers basically are you looking for? Take my case, say, I'm really interested I'm interested in this project. And basically I can involve even my wife. Basically, she's a housewife, so she's a graduate though. And basically, I'm from Orissa. There is one of the languages. So are you looking for languages? What are there any priorities of languages that you're looking for in India, or specific only to limited languages? What kind of volunteers basically are you looking for, and how to go about on this?
So I didn't hear you very clearly, so I'll try and paraphrase what I think the question was, and you can nod or shake your head. So you and your wife have some time. You'd like to know how you could volunteer. And I think the question was related to what sort of volunteering do you want, and is it just related to the Indian languages?
Right. Is it limited to, you are actually preferring some limited languages in India or most of the languages? So.
My mission is to make myself dispensable. So if the people in this room took over from me, I could rest and get a day job and earn money and my family would be happier. Of course, I'd probably still do this. But my encouragement is for people to take their own initiatives in this, a bit like I've done. And I just happen to have dedicated quite a lot of time to it for the last year or so. So is it just India? No. The reason I'm encouraging you here, because most of you are from India, and I see a dearth of the local languages in the software. So of course, I'm going to mention to you about your languages because it's something you can solve. If I asked you to do Swahili, for instance, chances are you don't know Swahili. I don't think anyone in this room speaks Swahili, do you? No. So you don't speak Swahili. There's little point in me asking you to do the translation into Swahili. Ultimately, you're not giving anything to me, by the way. You're contributing to an upstream open source project that happens to be on GitHub. Now, some of you may decide that you'd like to try the same ideas that I'm talking about. So working perhaps with a local school, perhaps providing Kindles. And for instance, some of the schools here are going to be using Kindles as mobile libraries with lots of e-books on them. So maybe you go and buy a Kindle and you use that. Maybe you buy an Android tablet and work with a local school. Maybe you want to copy the Rachel software onto a Raspberry Pi for, what, $100, including everything, and you donate it to a local school. And what I've done is here, this website, which is actually two Kiswahili words, is Kusaidia Mwalimu, and that means supporting teachers. So my focus is on trying to help the adults as well as the children. And on there, I publish sort of examples, feedback, reports from the schools. Now, I'm hopelessly out of date. I last published anything there about April for a bunch of reasons. So I've got a 4-5 month backlog to update. But that's where I put the materials. And it's all intended for you to copy the good bits and ignore the bad bits. So don't believe I'm the expert, because I'm not. I make lots of mistakes. And I want to explain the mistakes, so hopefully you can learn faster than I learned.
Sure.
The chap at the back, hopefully
yeah.
Mike's made
hello.
It.
Hello. My name is Sandesh. So thank you very much for all the activities that's being done. And I would like to take my own example wherein just for 6 words, we wanted to convert into 16, translate into 16 Indian languages, and that took us almost 3 weeks. That too after using Google Translator. So my question now, a suggestion kind of, have you ever tried to contact the Indian government, at least for the Indian languages? Because they have been very, very responsive, including the HRD ministry.
So again, I didn't hear everything. So I did hear you mention Google Translate, translating something that took 3 weeks, and 18 languages Google Translate, 3 weeks. Is that right?
Even after translation, we took the help of the volunteers to correct them.
Yes.
So that's one part. The second part is, have you tried to contact the Indian government? Especially because they have been very responsive, especially for these kind of activities. And you may even get it's just a suggestion. You may even get a, appointment with the Prime Minister, if possible.
I would be very happy to talk to anyone up to the Prime Minister level of any country. Not that I'm that special, but I'm not afraid of people. I think we're all basically, essentially, we should be equal as equal values of human beings. And I won't bore you too much with my family details, but my wife's family are a fairly august family. And so I'm not frightened of people, whatever their official title. I'm just aware they've got a heck of a lot going on. So my mission would be to help anyone who's interested. Google Translate is absolutely brilliant. I remember when the early days of the project came out, it was probably when I was still at Google, and we used to use it all the time. It wasn't brilliant at its translation, but now it's actually running on my little, I've got a little 8-inch Android tablet. It's my favorite tablet, because it has a nice little stand on it. It has an 18-hour battery life. And when I went to Spain, someone told me, an Indian in Santiago, he said, you do know that Google Translate's available offline now? I didn't know anything about it. Oh, brilliant. So I was able to download the offline pack for Spanish, which is the language I speak in Chile, 285 megabytes, I think it was. And it meant I could type in, I need to go to the toilet, where is it, please? And it actually translated it for me instantly, and it had audio. So I could even listen to the audio and then practice whatever the Spanish was for, I need a toilet now, please. Or I need directions, I'm lost. Or I'm late for the bus, which bus do I need to take to go where? And all of it is now free, running on a tablet. Absolutely brilliant. And yes, quite a few people, I think, I've heard of using it to do the translations, and then a human being has to correct it. Because sometimes, it gets it wrong, or there's a better choice of words. So yes, anyone who wants to do translations, please do use things like Google Translate and whatever other services are available. Next question.
I have one question for you. In our experience trying to build our startup with the education stuff, one of the things we found was that watching videos is great, but the retention by watching videos for kids is relatively less. If you get them to actively participate in something like an activity-based learning, then the retention is much higher. So after about 8 pivots, we ended up basically building a game to help kids learn stuff. So my question to you is, have you seen anything similar people are doing in terms of building games for helping kids to learn, you know, any of the subjects?
So the Khan Academy has got a bit of game theory in it, and particularly Khan Academy Lite. Providing the user logs in, so the pupil logs into the system, it gives them points for watching the videos. The videos are no longer than about 18 minutes long, and I'll come back to that in a second. So you get points for watching the videos, and for doing the mathematics exercises, you also get points. So there's, children can compete in a friendly way and say, you know, I got 623 points this week, you know, you only got 400 and whatever it is. So they're encouraged to use it more. Now, of course, we're testers. So it turns out I can just start the video on here, put it on the floor, and get 100%. Because it's only counting time. It isn't anything clever. So there's more to it. I mean, it's just a very simple game that's easy to be gamed. And Sal Khan wrote his book about turning education inside out. And based on his experience, he said that the human attention span is up to about 18 minutes for any single topic. By chance, his videos were 10 minutes long because that was the YouTube limit he had when he started posting the videos on. And then, yes, you need to do something else. The Indian school I visited down south of Chennai is all activity-based learning. So the kids all learn by doing. The classrooms are L-shaped by design so that you can't lecture to the children. They're not all sitting in front of you. And so the children are participating in the learning. And that work was taken out to initially, I think, 16,000 schools in Tamil Nadu state, and then to another 36,000 about 7 years ago. So I'm all for the activity-based learning. And I've seen too much rote learning, particularly in Kenya and here when I came last year. And I don't think that helps to make people who are equipped to think. And ultimately, we need to be able to think and enjoy thinking as adults. So I'm all for that. But I'm not focusing on encouraging that at the moment. I'm trying with these small baby steps to say, well, complementing this shortage of teachers, we can use technology. The kids can watch videos. They can do the mathematics online. They can use Wikipedia. Because I think if you try and change too much, and particularly when I'm not there in person, people are frightened. The biggest thing we have is fear of the teacher. So the teacher thinks that's going to, you know, do away with me. It's a bit like people saying, we're going to automate all the testing. And all the people who do interactive manual tests suddenly get frightened. Are they going to fire me now? You know, what's my job going to be in the next 5 years' time? Because I can't do this anymore. Well, a skilled interactive tester is still worth a tremendous amount to a project. But you have to overcome the fear factor to help people learn to cooperate. Any more questions?
I think we're running short of time, so thank you, Julian. That was very inspiring.
Thank you.
I think it needs a standing ovation. We're going to move on to closing the conference. We do need to announce the three winners of the Bug Bash, which Julian will do the honors. We did announce one of the winners in the morning. I think she's here. Yeah. I'm sorry, even I cannot pronounce your name exactly, so you'll have to help us. Vinitra. All right.
So we have to do the pack shot now, you see? So congratulations, this is a Raspberry Pi kit, model B+. Thank you, and I hope you have lots of fun playing with it. These are intended to be fun toys, so have fun with it first and then work out what to do with it. Thank you.
Thank you. We need to decide the two other winners.
Okay, well, you and I need to sit down for 2 minutes then.
We need our friends, Jyoti and
Pradeep. Yes, we should actually acknowledge them as well on video.
Yep. Could you please, guys, come over, Jyoti and... I keep forgetting his name.
Pradeep. Yes.
Sorry. Jyoti and Pradeep.
Or the panda, I think he
panda
likes.
Panda, that's what I remember, and I didn't want to put it up. Thank you guys for all your help with the Bug Bash. Thank you.
So these are two good friends of mine. I met Jyoti last year when I came to a conference, and she was fool enough to talk to me. And Pradeep, I've known a little bit longer from the conference circuit around the world. And when this proposal came to do the Bug Bash with automated tests, I thought it'd be great to have the complement of people who really focus on the human aspects of testing. And they've kindly given up these 2 days to work pretty much flat out in the other room. I don't think you've seen any talks, have you?
No.
No, they haven't seen any talks.
This one, at least.
Apart from this one. Right. So, yeah, and they've been helping out with people doing the interactive testing and providing general feedback. So thank you both very much.
Welcome.
I'm going to suggest that I go off mic and we have a little chat to do the final reviews for the two prizes.
Did you guys have anything you would like to share?
Yes, in fact, you can do that while we're chatting. There you go, that's easy.
Okay, entertaining people, that's very difficult. We had a great experience. We couldn't attend any of the talks, but I think it was great energy. And the way we started and the way we continued, okay, initially we had a few blocks in terms of identifying where do we report all these bugs. So it kind of, okay, we then set up GitHub, okay, to report the issues and all that stuff. The amount of questions that were asked, I think we were treated as developers of this, but you know, we had no clue and we pretended to be experts and solved all your problems. So if you believe that we were experts, we did, of course, okay, give based on our understanding. And okay, thank you very much for asking all those okay amazing questions and having done a wonderful okay job. I think okay, based on what okay Julian said, we should continue helping this okay Kiwix project, knowing that kids all across the world could benefit from this. So I am fully committed to this Kiwix project okay from now. So that's what I take away from working with you. Okay, thank you very much.
Hello all. I'd first like to thank Julian and Naresh for providing me with this opportunity. Last year when I met Julian, I went up to him and spoke to him, and he was taken aback because he was like, oh, it's a taboo in India for a girl to come over and speak to a man. Then I realized that Julian has had a great experience around the world meeting people, and he realizes what India needs. And after 1 year, I still see in this room that many people over here, sorry if I'm being, if I sound arrogant, but I really would like to say that stop asking permissions, and as Pradeep put it, believe in yourself. You may not be an expert, but you definitely have it in you to guide and help others. So I'd like to say that yeah, as long as you keep asking suggestions, you will keep asking them. And why not you become a role model than seeking out? And I don't know if the culture in India is like that, where a manager says something and everybody in the team has to listen to him. It need not be like that. And I have been in such situations where I've been told what to do. But I use this platform to tell that each of you and you know what to do. So put it to practice and inspire others. And one more tip I'd like to give. I've not seen any smiling faces in technical field. So I always see that people are really tired and worried and what the manager says, and they're too worried about that. So why not change that attitude and, you know, smile and be happy with your work and have fun and let the world know that there's more more beyond fear. So love your life and enjoy. And I'd like to thank each of you for listening to me. Thank you.
Just in time. The winners. Thank you.
Is it this time? Yours? Yeah. just go to this. Oh, it's saying it's just slow. Right, am I going to do this, or are you going to do this?
Go ahead.
Okay, fine. So what we've got here is the two winners. Unfortunately, their names are hard to work out because they have strange usernames on these systems, but we'll track them down and work out who they are. In this case, what we've got is...
So this is total the total 114 bugs that were open. One is closed, so that's brilliant. And then the first winner that we have is Sanmanve.
And he's probably left because
he's
of the
probably
flights.
Probably left, but we get him. We'll get him. So can you just quickly explain why you chose,
yes.
Why we chose him?
What we were looking for in terms of the bug reports was, of course, first of all, the bug. You know, what problem did they find? And then how well did they report the bug? How easy is it for us to reproduce the bug again? Because the developers are actually split around the world, so one's in Mali, one's in Switzerland, one is Germany, and then, of course, I'm here. So we have to be able to reproduce the bug accurately. We're looking at the quality of bug reporting. We're looking at how much they explored around the area. So if someone just says, clicked on this, it crashed, well, yeah, okay, you get 1 out of 10 for reporting a bug. But if you say, well, I tried this language and this language and this language, or I saw this pattern and the other pattern, then you're helping us to understand what the root cause of the problem is, and it makes it much easier to hone in on the problem. So here we've got 9 bugs reported. We've got a series, a bit hard for you to read, but you can see we've got a number of comments and discussions here on the bugs, including from the developers in Europe, who are the main core developers on the Kiwix project. So we can see that the bug reports are actually being accepted, dealt with, has made a good effort in terms of number of bugs.
Yep.
So he's the first one.
Sanmanve. And the second person is Kapil AG. Kapil AG actually contributed a test suite with CI integrated
in
it.
Yes, so this test suite is actually running CI. It's running tests on, I think, Source Labs on the iPad. He's tunneling back in onto his development machine. It can run in a continuous build environment. He's created the Jenkins scripts. So from start to finish, he's got some tests. I think there's 9 tests here for Kiwix running as a web server on his local machine. And I think he actually managed to get everything debugged, admittedly after the 2 o'clock deadline. But by 4 o'clock, he'd actually got everything up and running. And certainly even by 2 o'clock, he's streets ahead in terms of the quality of work and the volume of output. He did look a little bit frayed today when he was talking to me. So I think he spent a few extra hours on this. So congratulations as well. And I think I know that he left at 4:30 for his flight.
Okay.
So we'll have
both
to
of them have
them
left at 4:30, but we'll track them down and we'll make sure they get their Raspberry Pis.
Yes, and thank you very much for everyone who contributed.